I'm Jules from gfJules, and I am here to show you how easy it is to make homemade gluten-free hamburger buns. Really, really light and fluffy ones that everybody will love. There's so many options. I have actually a couple different recipes on my website at gfjules.com, which is right back here. You can find recipes for making them from scratch or from using my gluten-free bread mix, either one. And you can also mix it up by watching the video and using different types of liquids. You could use seltzer water, which is what I'm using today, because it doesn't really have much of a flavor to it, and it doesn't change the just the aroma that's baking. It doesn't change when it's finally done. It's just got this really clean, light bread taste. But I also like using gluten-free beer, of course. If you're worried about gluten-free beer, which ones are certified gluten-free, which ones are made from gluten-free grains, etc., I have a number of articles on my website at gfjules.com to help you find a gluten-free beer that makes a wonderful hamburger bun or for drinking. Either one. I like to use them to make breads like hamburger buns because you don't usually use the whole bottle, and then you have a little leftover that you can drink as well. So it's a happy medium. But there are, you can use ginger ale if you like a little bit of a sweeter bread. You could use, I've had people tell me that they use 7-Up before. So really anything sparkly like that is going to add a little bit more lift to the hamburger buns or to any kind of bread that you're baking. Also, when you're using my flour, the gfJules flour is so light. Those of you who have used it before or have been at my various shows, like I was in Pennsylvania last weekend, I always put a little bowl of flour out so people can touch it, because it's really amazing. Hi, thanks for joining me. It's really amazing just to touch it and feel it. In comparison to a lot of other gluten-free flours out there, it's not heavy, it's not gritty. So what you're gonna get as the end result is not gonna be heavy or gritty either. So, working with these ingredients, you're gonna get some great buns. Just to give you an example of what they look like when they're done, I'm gonna show you several different ways of making these buns today. Even if you don't have special pans or anything like that, I'm gonna show you some tricks. So this is a larger bun, obviously. You can make any size bun you want, but it's got this beautiful crumb on the inside, and it's really soft and fluffy. This is a smaller bun. I'll show you how to make all of these. You can make them big and tall and crowned on the top, or you can make them a little bit smaller and thinner, either one. And then, of course, this is my new favorite thing. Hi, thanks for joining me, y'all. My new favorite thing to do is to make these tiny little ones. How cute are these? These are like perfect for a party or for like this weekend, for example. You could have them sitting out for a Memorial Day party or whatever you want to do, or just yourself. But these are little tiny mini buns I'm going to show you how to make. And I just actually used, these are so great, these Hillary's Veggie Bites. They actually come in that size already, so they're vegan and gluten-free, and they're already really teeny tiny and cute. So I'm so glad you like my products. Thank you. So how cute are these? They're just called bites. They have all different flavors. So I'll show you how to make those tiny little buns too, and you can make these as appetizers. And I'll be putting this recipe up as well on my site, so you can look for this today. All right, so let me first of all show you some little kitchen hacks. So if you don't have a special bun pan, this is called a bun pan, and you can find these on Amazon, or I'm sure they have them at Michael's and places like that. But it's, as you can see, it's not very deep. So you put just a little bit of the batter in here and a little bit of batter on the other side, and you can put the two together and make a bun. If you don't have that though, sorry for the noise, these are English muffin rings, and this is what I use to make the really big bun, because they're taller, as you can see. It's much taller than the bun pan was. So you wanna fill up the ring with batter, but you don't wanna fill it all the way up, because when it gets too high, it'll crown over the top and it'll spill over the side like a muffin top, which is fine, but it just doesn't look like, you know, a bun should look. So anyway, if you're into looks, then you wanna make sure if you use this, you don't fill it all the way up. And what I do for these is I just put them on a parchment lined baking tray like this. And if you go to my website, and I'll actually put up when I'm done, I'll put the URL for the hamburger bun recipe that I'm making today. You can see examples of how far I fill these up and what they look like before they rise, after they rise, and when they're done baking. And then this is really super fun. I love doing this. So instead of buying the English muffin rings, which are not expensive, but you probably don't have them on hand right now. Ooh, there's just lovely breeze going through my kitchen. I love that, but it's not helping the pan. The paper. Okay, these you can find at Walmart or anywhere, you know, that sells any kind of canning stuff. Just these ball lids that you use for mason jars. I have a whole box of them, as you can see. They were not expensive. And they're like little rings. So you put them on here like this. And the key is just to make sure that you oil them really well, or you put butter on the inside so that the bun won't stick to them. But these are, you know, you could literally go out today and find these at the store, and you'd be ready to make your own hamburger buns this weekend. These are the regular size. You can also get large size as well. So another fun way of doing it. And then to make those little mini guys that I just showed you, these really super cute ones, that is just a mini muffin tray. And these also you can just find at the regular store. But again, you wanna make sure that you oil them or butter them really well. So I have my Earth Balance. This is what I like to use instead of regular butter because it's vegan, so there's no dairy or lactose or anything in it. So I just take this and go around the inside of the pan and make sure that I've gotten them really well oiled before I put my batter in there. Just because if they break when you're getting them out because they're stuck to the sides, it still works, but it's just not as pretty, right? So those are oiled, and I just need to wipe off my hands now. Let's see if I have a rag. Hang on one sec. Okay, have a rag. So the other things that you're gonna need are the ingredients on the recipe. And let me pull up my recipe so I can walk you through exactly what it is. What you wanna do is either you can just use my sandwich bread mix, which makes great hamburger buns. Follow the directions on the back of the hamburger buns, or on the back of the sandwich bread mix, and then just put it in whichever one of those bun containers that you wanna put it in to bake. So you could do a mixture like I did, where I made big and little and medium sized ones. And they also freeze really well. So what I'll do is I'll take them, because this makes a lot of buns. I'll take them like this, I'll slice them, and then I'll put a little piece of wax paper between them, and I put them in a zip top bag in the freezer. So anytime I want a bun, a soft, fresh baked bun, then I know I can just grab it out of there. And also this recipe, either using this or the scratch recipe, is easily made vegan. So if you have other food allergies or sensitivities, it's already dairy-free, nut-free, and you can make it egg-free easily. I'm gonna show you how to do it with eggs today, because most people do want to use the egg method, but if not, then I would suggest, I actually have a big long article on my website at gfjules.com on vegan egg replacers. But the one that I like to use for yeast breads like we're gonna make today is a flaxseed and water mixture. So if you're into finding good egg replacers, that's the one that I would recommend for yeast breads like this. So either use this method or you can follow along, and I'm gonna show you how to make it from scratch with my gfJules flour. Thank y'all for joining me, and I forgot to say this in the beginning. If you have questions, please feel free to type the questions in, and I will try to see them as they go. They kind of go up on my screen and sort of go from the top to the bottom, and I have a hard time reading them sometimes if they go quickly. So if you write in a question and I don't answer it right away, do it again, because it may have gotten moved and I wouldn't see it. At the end of the video, I will go back and answer any questions in text as well if I haven't gotten to them during the video. So, all right, so if you're following along on the website, it's gfjules.com, hamburger buns is the recipe that I'm using. And I have brought my ingredients to room temperature. So like I said, I'm using the eggs today, but you wouldn't have to, you could use the flaxseed meal and water. I'm also using sparkling water. This is at room temperature, and the eggs have been sitting out, and the other ingredients are also at room temperature. We're dealing with yeast today, and the reason why we want room temperature is because yeast is a living organism, and just kind of like, you know, you and me, if we want to be comfortable and we want to prosper, we need to have a certain temperature and a certain amount of moisture. So if you're super cold, you're not gonna do anything. You're just gonna stay like this. If you're super hot, you know, you might get burned. So with yeast, these are just little yeasty guys in here. We wanna wake them up with warm water, and we need to give them a little something to eat. So we're gonna give them a little bit of sugar, and we're gonna give them warm, you know, liquids. So it doesn't have to be hot. It doesn't have to be super warm, but just like room temperature to warm. And then we're gonna sit them, the dough, in the oven or outside to wait for them to rise. So we're gonna make a nice, lovely little environment for our yeasty friends, and we don't want it to be cold, because then it'll take too long for them to wake up. And if it's too hot, then it'll just scald them, and they won't, they can burn and die off too fast. So that's why everything here is at room temperature. If you're in a pinch though, and I'm often not prepared and I am running out of time, so what I'll do is if I'm taking fresh eggs out of the refrigerator and I need them to be room temperature, I'll put them in a bowl of warm water. I don't crack them, I leave them in the shell and let them sit in a bowl of warm water for a few minutes, and that takes the temperature right down. So it's really fast and it allows me to bake without a lot of thinking ahead, which is one of my hallmarks of my personality is I tend to just go with it, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, look at the time. But I still bake anyway. So. All right, so following along with the recipe, what we're gonna do, and I'm gonna use my stand mixer just because it's faster for me to mix it up, and I can show you how to do the dough, but you don't have to. Again, you could just use a wooden bowl with a spoon and mix it like that. This is a wetter batter, so you could probably use a hand mixer. I don't love using hand mixers because I hate when people come back and say, I burned the motor out of my hand mixer, and I feel bad. So a wetter dough like this, you could probably get away with a hand mixer, but I would almost err just on the side of just good old fashioned, you know, beating it with your spoon in a bowl. But we're gonna do it today in the mixer. And then just real quickly, I'll tell you, because everyone always asks about my mixer and the accessories that I have. This, it's a KitchenAid mixer, I love it. It's, you know, works wonders on just about anything. But this is not a KitchenAid blade. This is something called a beater blade. And I ordered this off of another website. I'm sure you can find it on Amazon or something. But you have to get the one that's the right size for your actual mixer bowl and head. And it has this rubber gasket on it, if you can see that right there. It acts like a rubber spatula. And so when it's stirring, it's getting all around the inside of the bowl. So you don't have to stop and do this, you know, around the side with the spatula as often. Again, time-saving trick that I happen to like, but you could just use a regular paddle. I don't like using the dough hook ever with gluten-free dough because I don't feel like it gets it really mixed up well. So I don't really ever use the dough hook. So I'm either using the paddle or I'm using the whisk attachment for things like meringues and frostings and things like that. This is my go-to old standby. It is a little bit squeaky, so I'm gonna probably just use the regular one so that you won't have to listen to the high-pitched squeak that this makes in my mixer. So anyway, all right, so that's aside. And what I'm gonna do first is I'm gonna mix up my wet ingredients, except I'm not gonna add this yet, and I'll tell you why in a second. So here we go with the eggs. I'm just gonna put the eggs in. And I got my kids started really early cracking eggs because I think it's just a life skill. Obviously, if you can't have eggs, you don't need this life skill. But otherwise, it is a life skill. If you do happen to get some shell in here, the best way to get it out is to take the rest of the shell and just go into the bowl where the shell is, and you can pick it up that way. If you've ever tried to get it with your finger, it just keeps going the other way. So see, there's a question. Great tips on, oh yeah, sure, happy to help you with a beater blade. And I probably have a link to the beater blade somewhere on my site, but just make sure you get the one that's the right size for your mixer because they come in all different sizes and shapes. So I've got three eggs in here, and then I've got 3 tablespoons of olive oil, and measure that out. And then I have 2 tablespoons of honey or agave. Depends on if you are making it egg-free and you want it to be vegan, then you wouldn't want to use honey. You'd use agave or coconut nectar. You could even use maple syrup. It will change the taste of the buns. I mean, I love maple syrup, so maybe you would like that taste, but it will make it a little bit of a darker color as well. But you just want a little bit of a liquid sugar type of thing in there. The nice thing about agave and honey is that they are actually humectants, and so they will help to preserve the moisture in the final baked good. So it's nice to add those when you can because it helps them to keep fresher longer. Like the buns I showed you earlier that were nice and squishy, those I made yesterday and they're still, you know, yummy and soft. And obviously you could heat them up, but you don't have to, which is nice, right? We like that. Okay, so those are our liquid. Oh, wait a minute. I have one more. Apple cider vinegar. That will help to wake up the yeast as well. So that's just 1 teaspoon. And again, the recipe is at gfjules.com. Let me just put this in here. And actually, I don't have my other paddle right here, so I'm just gonna go ahead and grin and bear it. See, it's squeaky, sorry. Okay, so we added that. And I just gave it a little mix just to mix up the eggs primarily. Okay, now I'm gonna move on to my dry ingredients. Now the way you want to measure your dry ingredients, your flours. It doesn't matter so much for sugar because it's not something that can compact. Ideally, you will have a food scale, but if you don't have a food scale, that's okay. I'm gonna show you how to actually measure them out. I have been trying in my most recent recipes to give you the weights for the flours, because I think if you do have a food scale, that's the surefire way to make sure that you've gotten the exact proportions that you need. A lot of times people will tend to maybe take the measuring cup and they'll scoop it into the flour. And if you do that, then it compacts the flour and you can actually throw the recipe off by as much as 25%. And you don't want to do that, because if you have something that's, maybe it turns out it's dry or the dough won't come together and it's crumbly, you may have added too much flour to it. And so you want to make sure you do have the exact right amount of flour. In this recipe, actually I'll use this. In this recipe, I think we have 2 1/4 cups or something. Let me look. 2 3/4 cups, which is 371 grams of flour. If you forget how much my flour weighs, it's at the FAQs on my website. You can always find that, but my flour is 135 grams per cup. So, well, actually someone just asked me today, how do you store your flour? I just keep it in this Lucite container, which has a rubber thingy around the top, which helps to keep the moisture out of it. And then I always know when I need more because it's clear. You don't have to do that. You could put it in a zip top bag. I know some people keep it, the larger size of my flour is in a 4.5 pound bag. Some people keep it in that and just roll it over and seal it. And then of course this one has a resealable top. So if you have this size, you can just keep it in here. The key is that you just don't want moisture or bugs getting in there. Store it at room temperature is totally fine. You do not need to refrigerate or freeze it. It does not have, it's not high fat, high protein flour at all. So it, the things that would tend to go bad in a flour that you would want to refrigerate it are not in here. So you do not need to refrigerate it or freeze it. But if you choose to do that, with, just like with any other flour, if you take it out and let it come to room temperature before you measure it, because otherwise the measurements will be off because it's cold and dense. Okay? All right, so I know that I need 371 grams, so I would just, you know, put that in here if I knew that that's what I wanted. But and this is actually, whoa, that was loud, I'm sorry. But if I'm measuring it this way, I want to take a scoop and put the flour in here like this. And then when I get to the top, then I will just use a knife or the side of the scooper like that, and you just go straight across the top, just like that. And we know we have, that's 1 cup of flour. So I'm gonna just put it in here, and I'll know I need to add that there in just a second. So I'm gonna finish my measurement here to get up to 371. And in the meantime, I will tell you that the other dry ingredient that you're gonna add, the other primary one, is a milk powder. And I have used several different kinds because I'm dairy-free. I don't use any dairy in any of my recipes or any of my products. But I have tried lots of different products trying to get to one that will actually work really well being dairy-free. And I found a couple. One of them is actually called dairy-free, but it's really hard to find and it's kind of expensive. So I was looking around for some other options, and this is the one that I used today. And I realize this is backwards because we're doing FaceTime Live, so Facebook Live. I'm sorry that this is backwards, but this is dairy-free vegan coconut milk powder. And if you go to my website and look up the article or the recipe for this, I do have this linked in there so you can find the one that I'm using, but there are lots of them out there. All it is coconut milk with a little bit of tapioca maltodextrin to sort of keep it from getting too clumpy. So, and that's what I'm using here. So I have 1/4 cup of that, and it is a little bit clumpy, so I sort of sifted it with my fingers, but I'm gonna mix it in here with my other flour real quick. And then I'm gonna add all of that to the bowl with my wet ingredients. And you could sift this if you wanted to. You could whisk it, you could do, hi! I see someone's here from Richmond. I'll be in Richmond again this summer at the Gluten-Free Food Allergy Fest. So hopefully I'll get to see you there this summer. That'll be fun. I love doing those things. So I add that here. Along with, I have a little bit of sugar, 1 tablespoon, and a little bit of salt, 1 teaspoon. And again, remember the sugar is to help wake up the yeast, give it something to eat, and the salt is also there for some flavoring. It tastes, you know, it's good, better with salt, but if you have to cut back on your salt, you can absolutely leave that out or reduce the salt ingredient. going over everything, blah, 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 blah. Okay, got it all. Now I'm going to add my final liquid here. The reason why I'm adding it last is because I have liquid on the bottom, dry ingredients, and then putting this on top so that when I turn on my mixer, it's not gonna just go poof and then all the dry ingredients fly everywhere. I've learned this the hard way. So I'm putting my liquids on the top, the final liquid, just to get the dry ingredients a little bit wetter on the top so that they won't fly out. I'm gonna put this in the mixer real quick, and I won't need to mix it long. But I will come back to you and talk to you here in a second about yeast, because that's the last piece of this puzzle. Now again, if you were using my sandwich bread mix, thank you for all the hearts, then the yeast packet comes in here with it. But if you're not using my sandwich bread mix and you're using this, making this from scratch, then you're gonna wanna go and buy some yeast. And the one that I like, this is one, Fleischmann's, and then also Red Star. I like the Rapid Rise. Let's see, I will be there. Yes, great. I hope to see you at the Richmond Fest. I like the Rapid Rise because when we are doing gluten-free yeast breads, we can skip a whole bunch of steps that you couldn't skip if you were making a gluten yeast bread. And one of the biggest ones is the period of time between mixing it and baking it is shorter. And the reason is because in traditional bread baking, using gluten flours, you want to exercise the gluten because that gives you lots more stretchiness to hold the final bread together, and it helps you to get these beautiful pockets in it, like this one. This is the one, the inside of the bread that I made yesterday. This looks like a normal hamburger bread. Looks like a great bun, nice spongy texture, soft, but it's not made with gluten. It's made gluten-free. The reason is because we are not gonna do all of the steps to exercise the gluten because we have no gluten. And if we took all of those steps, we would be actually punching the air out of our bread. So the punch down, the second rise, the kneading, all that stuff, don't do it, because if you do, you will punch the life out of your bread. I've got a couple questions here. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you, you're so sweet. Yay, thanks. So basically all we're gonna do is, actually I probably should get some scissors, is add the yeast in, and this is almost done. Just as long as it's mixed up, it's done. So we'll add the yeast in, and then as soon as it's integrated, we will be done with our dough. So all we have to do at that point is rise it. We don't have to wait, we don't have to knead it or do anything like that. And again, you don't want to do that. I have a lot of people tell me that they want to use their grandma's recipe for cinnamon rolls or something like that, which is great. And I'm so happy that you're digging out those old recipes, but you can't follow grandma's directions because grandma would tell you that you have to put it in a bowl, cover it, let it sit out for a couple hours, come back, punch it down, do all that stuff. We do not want to do that. So follow the directions on my buns recipe or on my sandwich bread mix, and then you will have a beautiful bread that's not dense or hard because you punched the life out of it. Do you have a Facebook page? Okay, I think someone's asking someone else if they have a Facebook page. So you guys are free to talk amongst yourselves about that. Okay, so all I'm doing here is just taking the dough off of the batter or the beater blade here, making sure it's all integrated and the yeast is all inside. And I'll show you what the texture and the consistency of this batter is. And again, I'm not really calling it dough because it's kind of wetter than dough, but it's either batter or dough, whichever one you want to call it, I guess. All right, so set that aside. And you can see, like, if I was using just a wooden spoon and a bowl, it's easy for me to mix this up, right? It's not too thick. So if you can see, here's the batter, like that. So it's, it's thick, but it's not certainly not insanely thick. And it's not something that you would want to knead. So how do you suggest keeping the leftovers? Okay. And yes, do you have a challah recipe? Yes, I absolutely have a challah recipe. It's actually one of the most popular recipes on my site. If you go to gfjules.com and type in challah, you'll come up with, there's a braided crown challah, and I also have just the regular braided one with apples and raisins. So they're fantabulous. I mean, my kids love them. When we make pizza a lot, and My pizza dough recipe or my pizza mix calls for egg whites, and so I'll save the yolks and I'll make challah. I love doing that, so it's so yummy. And then in terms of the leftovers, I talked about this a little bit earlier. If you go back and watch the whole thing, you'll see it. But basically what I do is I will cut them in half, and I'll put a little piece of wax paper in between, and then I'll put this in a freezer bag, or you know, a bunch of them in a freezer bag. And then you just take them out whenever you want one, which is pretty handy because, you know, sometimes I'll just want like a quick veggie burger for lunch or something like that. And then I just have a hamburger bun ready to go. Do we have a cookbook? Yes. Okay. Okay. I can't read that last part. I'm so sorry. I have two cookbooks, and I also have a book on living gluten-free called The First Year Celiac Disease and Living Gluten-Free. If you go onto my website, there are links for some of those, but you can find any of my cookbooks on Amazon or I'm sure Barnes & Noble or whatever. Just type in Jules Shepard and you'll come up with the recipe books. I also have a bunch of ebooks at gfjules.com. And then don't forget, at gfjules.com I have 430 now, I think, free gluten-free recipes. And so you can type in challah or whatever it is you're looking for in the search bar, and it'll come up with lots of different options. And so hopefully you'll find what you need there. So yes, and you are very, very welcome. Thank you for your questions. All right, so here's the fun part now. Let me set all these things aside. So I showed you earlier how I buttered this mini pan, because the first thing I'm gonna do is make these cute little guys right here for parties or for, you know, like for the holiday coming up. These little minis right here, they're so cute. They're made with the Hillary's veggie bites, which are vegan and gluten-free, and they're already come in that size, which is really handy. Okay, so the easiest way to do this is if you have a small ice cream scoop or cookie scoop like this, then I like to scoop it and put it in there. Otherwise, you just have two spoons and you just spoon it in. Another question. So basically, I just scoop it in here like this, and then obviously I put it in the pan. I do not want to fill up the pan though, because then it's going to spill over, like I said earlier, and may have like a muffin top, which again, it's not going to taste any different, but this is a neater looking bun. So I'm just going to do this a couple times just to show you. And if it starts sticking to this, I just have a bowl of water and I just dip it back in water. So, let's see. And then when I'm done, let's say that I did the whole tray like that, then I want to get a small spatula, or you could use your fingers, get your fingers wet or the spatula wet, and then you just smooth the tops with the wet spatula or with your fingers, because that will help the, when it bakes, it'll help to make it prettier. And at this point, if you wanted to put something on top, like you know, sesame seeds or poppy seeds or you know, anything like that, you could do that as well. I like to, before I bake it, just go back and put a little bit of oil on the top, because it helps them to brown. So I'll take a just a little bowl, or you know, the leftover olive oil, and brush this on top of, whoops, just dripped. Brush this on top of the buns, which also helps to smooth them out. And then I can put my seeds or whatever I want to on top of that. So that's how you would do it in this one. And this makes a ton of these little guys. I don't even know how many it makes. I gotta figure that out, because every time I've done it, I've made a bunch of these and I made a bunch of the other ones, which is great because you can put them in the freezer for leftovers. Now, if you're gonna use my little trick with the mason jar lids, like these, it's easier, I mean, you could certainly butter them if you wanted to, but it's easier, I think, just to go ahead and spray it. So I spray them really well on the inside. And the same goes if you're using the English muffin rings. And by the way, yes, I do have an English muffin recipe at gfjules.com, and it's really easy, so check into that when you get a chance. All right, so I put them on the tray like this, and I'm gonna do the same thing, only with a bigger scooper. A regular size ice cream scooper, or you could again just use a big spoon. And I'm just going to place it kind of in the middle, and I don't want too much in there because it is going to rise a lot, and I don't want it to rise up too much. Like that's going to be too much. I'm going to have to cut that out, which is fine. You just go back with your spoon or spatula. and smooth it out or cut out some of the top of it. So I'll just scoop it out with my spatula. And I got too much, so I just took the top off of it there. No big deal. Now, go back with my oil. And this is going to spread inside this ring here. So I'm not too worried about it, you know, reaching the sides of the of this particular ring. But it's a little bit harder sometimes with the smaller rings to not put too much in there. But the other thing I'll just tell you is if you're using different sizes like this, try to get the same amount of dough in there because they're gonna bake at a different rate. So, you know, if you've got a whole bunch more dough inside of one and not the other one, the one with more dough inside is gonna need to cook longer and you don't wanna overcook your other ones. And that's the danger with these little ones too. These don't need very much time at all. In fact, I think last time I did it, yesterday, I maybe overcooked them a little bit because, you know, they hardly need any time at all. So I'm gonna start testing them at about 10 minutes and see if that's enough. I think I cooked them at 12 minutes last time. So I'm just gonna stick a toothpick in it, and if it comes out clean, then I know that they're done. And they start smelling really good too when you can tell that the dough is about ready to be done. So we have English muffin rings. We have mason jar lids. We have muffin or the bun pans. We have the mini pans. And then we have, you know, just baking it this way. Any way you do it, and yes, there are hot dog bun pans out there. I have one linked in my article for the gluten-free hamburger buns. You can make them any shape or size you want. And even if you don't end up having any rings at all, you can just take a spoon and go on the pan, and it becomes like this big sort of free-formed Kaiser roll looking thing. And if you smooth it with your fingers or with a wet spatula, you know, then it looks nice. It looks like you meant to do that. So don't feel kind of funny about that. Yeah, a muffin top pan is another good thing to use, Nora. Thank you. But you see how long this took me, and that was it. The longest time in this whole process is just putting it in the pan. I'm gonna now stick it in my oven, which I've had preheated to 200. I'm gonna turn the oven off. I'm gonna maybe stick a bowl of water in there. Kind of helps with a little bit of the rising, but you don't have to. Put these guys back in the oven, let them sit in there for about 30 minutes with the oven off. I'm gonna preheat my oven, and when the 30 minutes is up and they've risen, and I don't want them to rise higher really than the top of the pan, so you might not even need 30 minutes for them to rise. Then you just bake them for, you know, 10 minutes, like I said, or the longer ones for the bigger ones. And you're done. And you have hamburger buns, soft, fresh, homemade hamburger buns that smell amazing. And you can have them, you know, like for a party, like these ones with the Hillary's little bites in them, the veggie bites. Or you could make, obviously, your own little burgers. You could make, you know, mushroom burgers. You could do anything you want to do with these little ones. They're so fun. Or you could just have the big ones and make a regular burger. So that's, you know, pretty much it. Another question, can you use rice flour for these? No, you cannot, because rice flour is gritty and it doesn't hold together. So that's, again, like I talked about at the very beginning, that's why my flour is so amazing, because it's exactly the right proportion of all of the soft, light, airy flours that you need, combined with enough of the stick-to-it-ness to hold it together and give you that gorgeous crumb. If you made this with rice flour, not only would it be gritty, but it would also fall apart and it would be dry and crumbly. And everyone would know you made gluten-free buns. This way, no one's gonna know you make gluten-free buns. Yes, you do need to try the hamburger buns, because this was easy, right? I mean, I was chatty, but like it still didn't take that long. And we'll have fresh buns within an hour of start to finish. So it doesn't need a lot of preparation. You honestly don't need to spend a lot of money, like, you know, rings from Walmart you know, to get the ball, little wide mouth or regular mouth lids. So it's really pretty easy, and you could, you know, show people, and this is kind of fancy and fun, and they'll think that it's very impressive that you made your own buns, but, you know, we don't have to tell them it was easy, right? So any other questions that y'all have, please feel free to type them in here and I will get back to you in text. You can always reach me at gfjules.com, which is the website here that has the searchable recipe database and also has all of my award-winning products, including the sandwich bread mix, which also makes great buns. And also the flour. You can find it all there. And you can reach me there or here on Facebook at gfJules. I'm here to help you and to make your baking adventures a little bit easier. Can you use your all-purpose flour for anything? Yes, absolutely. Absolutely, 100%. I use it for everything. I make homemade bagels, obviously. We use it for buns, for pizza, for cookies, cakes, roux. I have readers tell me they use it for fried chicken, and it's awesome for that. I'm trying to think any other funky things. I make homemade pasta with it, cinnamon rolls, you name it. Like, it's just, it's perfect for everything because it's not heavy and it does have some binding properties. It has a natural preservative in it, so your baked goods do stay fresh longer, and it's just great. I love it. It took me years to develop it, and I did it for myself because I have celiac disease, and I could not believe how bad all the products were that were on the market. And honestly, there still are so many bad products. It's very sad. So I bake whatever I want to, and it doesn't take long because I make sure my recipes are easy because I don't have the patience for making long, complicated, intricate recipes. So pancakes, crepes, thank you, Nora. Yes, makes great pancakes and crepes. I haven't tried it. Well, Kim, you got to try it on the pancakes or the crepes or the hamburger buns, whatever you like. I would say pick something that you haven't had in a really long time that you've been dying to have. When I ask people that question, they usually say homemade cinnamon rolls. And I have 3 or 4 homemade cinnamon rolls recipes on my website, including one that does not call for yeast and it's ready start to finish in less than 52 minutes. So you could be eating cinnamon rolls in less than an hour if you wanted to dive into that recipe. It's been so frustrating trying to find a good flour. I know, that's why I created my flour, because I was so frustrated. And in fact, over the years, because I created this flour first in 2006, and over the years I've made it better and better and better as there have been new products that have come available, like the natural preservatives that I was talking about earlier. It's amazing all of the wonderful things that I can make now that I couldn't even make with my earlier incarnations of my flour. It's liberating and it's fun when you know you have something you can trust and you go in the kitchen and you're gonna be able to make something that's yummy. And you don't have to throw it away I have shed many a tear over pie crust. And I've thrown pie crust before. Luckily I didn't throw a pie pan, but I did throw the pie crust. I've sworn that I was giving it all up and I was never gonna try again. Like, I've been through all of those other flours. I've been through all of that and I get it. And now pie crust is one of my favorite things to make because it's so darn easy. It is so light and flaky. I know it's gonna work, and so I know I can budget my time because I know it's not gonna be one of those things where I'm gonna have to redo it or whatever, and it just makes life easy again. And so I hope that you find that as well, Kim, and I hope that you challenge yourself to find some new recipes and to do some fun baking maybe over this weekend, have a baking adventure, and have fun again, because that's what I want for you. I wanted that for myself, and it's been so liberating and so empowering that I wanted to be able to share that experience with others, because I know there are tons of people out there who are still frustrated and are spending their money on crazy stuff that doesn't work, and it is very disheartening at times, but I think you're going to be very, very pleased with my flour because it's a lot of fun. And just, you could even start on my website. There's over 430 recipes there. Search one, find it. Maybe it's hamburger buns, maybe it's something else. And give it a try, and I'd love to hear back about what you think. Thank you all for joining me, and again, if you still have some more questions, type them in. I will be back to you, but you can always reach out to me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Pinterest, or just at gfjules.com. Happy baking, y'all.